Hello students, this is our second part of Ambedkar's ideas on democracy, right? So previously we discussed the various aspects of democracy propounded by Ambedkar and types of democracy and so on and so forth. And last one we discussed economic democracy as defined by Dr. Bhimrao Ambedkar. Now here we will discuss the challenges of democracy by Ambedkar. What are the challenges of democracy? More particularly, our focus would be on India. Okay, so the Ambedkar says about challenges before democracy in India, that is one aspect we are going to discuss. Now see, when we talk about democracy, the idea which was given by Bhimrao Ambedkar, then we came to know that he thinks democracy to be more than a form of government. For him, democracy is not merely a form of government, but more than a form of government. And he says that the roots of democracy are to be searched in the social relationship, in the terms of associated life between the people who form a society. For example, various religious groups or caste groups or gender relations in a society. So all these things he talks about in his concept of social democracy, and we discussed social democracy in our last lecture. Now, what is the qualities of this democracy according to Ambedkar? He says that the qualities which accompany this unity are praiseworthy community of purpose and desire for welfare, loyalty to public ends, and mutuality of sympathy and cooperation. It means his idea of democracy based on unity, number one, number two, purpose, okay, and number three, welfare. So all these things together can have a true sense of democracy in India, at least. Now, he says, on the contrary, that all these qualities are not found in Indian democracy. Why? Because there are several factors involved in it. What are these factors? Casteism, number one. Gender biasness, number two. Regionalism, language issues, feeling of religious superiority, and so on and so forth. So he says that all these aspects are the main hindrance in the having a strong democracy in India, and these are the challenges before Indian democracy. Okay, now Indian society simply does not consist of individual, according to Ambedkar. It does not consist of individual, rather it consists of castes. It means what democracy demands? Democracy demands that there should be individuals. Those individuals should be the citizens. But here Ambedkar is saying that in India, what we have is caste and not individual. Whatever the relation we have as an Indian, or whatever feeling for community we have as an Indian, it is just because of our caste identity. See, what he says that a Indian do not talk to a Indian, a Indian do not marry with an Indian, and a Indian do not touch the other Indian, or an Indian is not ready to have food from other Indian. Now, who is one Indian and who is the other Indian? The one Indian is upper caste Indian, and the other Indian is the lower caste Indians. So these types weakens these structures, rather weakens our democratic structure, and so we have to wither away from the structure of casteism or hierarchies of casteism, and we must have individuals in India, and not the caste persons, right? Now, this was his first aspect about challenges before democracy in India. Now, second one is the economy. In economy also, he says that various jobs, various industries, in society we have seen, in politics we discussed the dominance of upper caste. He also here is saying that in economic arena, the upper caste dominates, whether it is industries, whether it is jobs, whether it is higher education, and so on and so forth. Here, the caste Hindus, the upper caste Hindus, do not allow the lower caste Hindus to have their share. Okay, so what should be the criteria? The criteria should be liberty, equality, justice, and fraternity. And here, what we see during those days, at least, that all the criteria was there, but casteism was having an upper hand in Indian society. So that is why these constitutional values simply did not have any concrete meaning according to Ambedkar. So first we have to make or rather maintain equality, liberty, and justice, fraternity, then only we can have a good society with at least economic equality, a kind of economic equality. At least we can assume that if someone is capable of doing of something, so he or she should not be stopped on the basis of his or her caste. So this was his idea. And about monopoly of you can say wealth, he is saying the Jain, for example, or Marwadi, according to Ambedkar, or Brahmin, or any other caste in India, these castes always leave money for their own castes or for their own family and not for the outcasts, for example, Dalits or untouchables, okay, or downtrodden section of the society. There is simply no room for them in this entire economic structure. Secondly, they do not have their due share in politics, industry, commerce, and in education. So, where will they go and how will they survive in the newly independent country like India? So this was the biggest challenge according to him. Next point is, he says that caste system accompanied by always a graded inequality according to Ambedkar, and this graded inequality puts a great threat to democracy in India. Castes are not equal in their status, they are standing one above another. We can see it from top to bottom. All of the caste groups are jealous of each other. Okay, they hate each other according to Ambedkar, and therefore it destroys willing and helpful cooperation. In the absence of willingness and helpful cooperation, we cannot have a strong democracy, because each and every citizen should have a kind of willingness and helpful cooperation for their fellow citizens to have a healthy democracy, and that is entirely absent in India. So this was his another challenge which India was facing at that time. Next is the fixation of occupation in caste system, okay, that cuts the very roots of democracy. Now, what is that? It means one caste is bound to one occupation only. Okay, Brahmins to teach, Kshatriyas to rule, Vaishya communities to for business, and lower caste groups to serve others. Now, this type of structure, although it might have changed because of modern colonial state, but the essence of this casteism was not changed at all, according to Ambedkar. Society is no doubt stable, and organized when each individual is doing that for which he has been aptitude by nature in such a way as to be useful to others. This is what Ambedkar says. And that it is the business of society to discover these aptitudes and progressively to train them for social use. It means one has to come forward to train those who are not trained enough, to have their maximum social use if they have the capability, or willingness to do some work. So the society must come forward, and that was not happening in India, according to Ambedkar. For the society to be democratic, one should open a way to use all the capacities of the individual. Okay, stratification in the name of caste, in the name of religion, in the name of gender, and more particularly in the name of caste, will always hinder an individual to grow. One, and second, to deliberate denial of democracy. It means if someone is being stopped to do something, okay, because of someone's caste, then it is a deliberate denial of democracy, according to Ambedkar. So he simply talks about that one should respect liberty, equality, of every individual with fraternity and justice. This was his main idea. Now, next, after discussing the challenges before democracy, he talks about what are the conditions for having a successful democracy in India, and how can we have a successful democracy in India. So first condition is, according to Ambedkar, is successful working of democracy is that there must be no inequality of oppressed class, and their subjugation in India. The society should not be divided on the basis of oppressed class and suppressed class. The society rather should be divided between or among individuals, and not between upper caste and lower caste, oppressed caste and suppressed caste. If we have such type of society which divides a person, not because of his or her identity, but because of his or her natural identity, that is individualness, then we can have a strong democracy in India. This was his first condition. Now, what was the second condition? The second thing which he talks about and he says that a successful working of democracy requires the existence of opposition. It means the veto power should always be used by strong opposition. Suppose if there is weak opposition, if there is no opposition, then the ruling party may behave like a dictator. Okay, so he knows the value of opposition in parliamentary democracy, and he was a strict adherent of parliamentary democracy, as we discussed earlier. He was a strict adherent of parliamentary democracy in India. So he says that democracy is a contradiction of hereditary authority or autocratic authority, and to avoid this contradiction, he favored a strong opposition to check the functions of the government. It means there should be some political parties, or one political strong political party, to acquire the position of opposition in the parliament, to oppose or to suggest government in its various functions, and to check the various functions of the government. Otherwise, democracy will lose its meaning. So, to have a successful democracy, we must have a strong opposition. The third condition. In the third condition, for to have a successful democracy, he says that equality in law and administration is a necessary condition. Now, he says that for efficient functioning of any administration, in democracy, there is need of a permanent civil servant, civil services. Why? To implement the policy of the government without fear of the executive. See, generally we see in USA when president election is over and some other president comes up from some other party, what he do, he replaces the earlier regime of the earlier civil servants from the past regime with his or her own loyals and so on and so forth. So there is no consistency, there is no permanency in such a system where administrators or administration fears the executive. So he warns the executive not to create panic among the administration. If there is no peer pressure among administrators, then they will do their duties responsibly. Okay, and they will do their duties honestly and in a democratic way. Once they do all these things, then we will have a strong democracy in India. So the administration should be entirely free from pressure from the executive. Next condition is observance of constitutional morality and ethics. See, he believe in constitutional morality and constitutional ethics. See, we see that in politics there is complete absence of morality and ethics, and Ambedkar on the contrary talks about morality and ethics in politics. He also supported Laski's writings on conventions of the constitution, that the king must accept the advice of the prime minister, and if the king does not accept the advice of the prime minister, then the prime minister shall force his ejection. It means PM can remove the king. Laski was saying this. Ambedkar supported Laski, and he says that if any government fails to deliver good, fails to deliver what it is expected to do, then the government must be removed by following constitutional morality and ethics. Okay, whatever the provision constitution talks about for the removal of the government. And he believed that violation of constitutional morality would damage the constitution and the democracy as well. So if government is not doing what it is expected, then there should be a provision to remove that government. Okay, but the removal of the government should entirely be based on morality and ethics, constitutional morality and constitutional ethics. And if it is removed without constitutional morality and constitutional ethics, the removal itself will lose its meaning and it will be an attack on democracy. So to make democracy strong, we have to make, in a nutshell, he is trying to say that we have to make government accountable. Okay, so this was his argument in this point. Now, next is there must not be the tyranny of majority in democracy, according to Ambedkar. Now, what is that? Here, majority doesn't mean Hindus, minority doesn't mean Muslims and Christians. Majority means those who are in power with the largest number of seats with their supporters, right? And minority means those who are in opposition with their supporters. So they are political majority and political minority, and not the religious majority and religious minorities. So here Ambedkar is talking about political majority and political minority. Keep this in mind. And he says that the voice of minority in house or in the parliament must be heard, or these minorities may start on unconstitutionally. See, if the ruling regime simply avoid the voice of minorities, for example, those who could not secure many seats or many supporters, then these minorities, political minorities, may start behaving unconstitutionally. And that he didn't want. He wanted that the ruling regime must listen to all, whether they are majority and they are minorities, and the ruling regime must welcome various ideas, and not just one or two ideas, according to Ambedkar. So if the party in power listen to the minorities, political minorities, then it is a, we can say that we have a strong democracy here in India. And if party in power simply avoid the voice of political minority, then we have no choice but to say that we do not have a strong democracy in India. Last, he talks about public consign. What is that? He says that anywhere against any individual, if injustice is done and people come forward to help, okay, or to oppose that justice without thinking about caste, religion, gender, and so on and so forth, and oppose that act and stand by or stand with the oppressed, then it is a public consign. Here Ambedkar says that any individual or community, without thinking that I am from this community, I am from that community, he is from or she is from this community, or he or she is from that community, so we must not speak for him or her. That is the death of public conscience. But if people start matching their voice with the person who faced a kind of discrimination or injustice and so on and so forth, then this is known as the public conscience. He says for a strong democracy, this public conscience is the most important element, because democracy is the government for the people. Now, what are the things which are necessary to have or to maintain good democracy in India? Number one, constitutional methods, strict adherent of constitutional principles, Dr. Bhimrao Ambedkar. And he says that to achieve social and economic objective, we must only use constitutional method and not non-constitutional methods. So in that sense, he completely reject the idea of revolution. He completely reject the ideas of violent revolutions to change the society. He supports the idea of constitutional reforms to change the society in a gradual way. He also favored abandonment of or complete removal of civil disobedience, non-cooperation and satyagrahas. We may have certain reservations about it. We may say yes, we may say no, but at least many will agree over it that these methods, yes, if it is violent, we must oppose it, because there is no room or no place for violence in democratic society. But as far as civil disobedience and satyagraha is concerned, we have seen civil disobedience during Indira Gandhi regime before emergency, and during Manmohan Singh's era when we saw satyagraha by Anna Hazare. See, if these two movements was not there, then we simply did not have the right to protest or to resist our voice. So here we can say that civil disobedience and satyagraha is a necessary condition, or it should be the basic right to oppose among the people. Why Ambedkar is opposing it? Because earlier it was used against the state, against the constitution, against the various policies which where colonial state was trying to introduce. Here, after independence, satyagraha of Anna Hazare was against corruption, and JP movement was against corruption and over dominance or over centralization of one political party. So here we can say that these two things are important element. Next is liberty. No lay liberties at the feet of a great man. It means there is no great leader. If someone has done something good, we must praise. We must praise the leader. But it doesn't mean that no, we should blindly start supporting that leader or that particular politician. So politician worship is bad for democracy, according to Ambedkar. Here he says that if we do such activities, making someone hero in politics, that heroism or that hero worshipping may open the road for dictatorship in India. These Indians simply do not value democracy. So Indians must learn not to blindly support any leader or any politician. Okay, here he is saying that we must praise them, but praise them with logic, not blindly, to have a strong democracy here in India. Last is, Ambedkar wanted to make political democracy a social democracy. Ambedkar suggested that we must make our political democracy a social democracy, because political democracy cannot last unless there lies at the base of its social democracy. So without social democracy, we cannot have a political democracy. What is social democracy? Although we discussed in our previous class, social democracy in a nutshell, it is a way of life which recognizes liberty, equality, justice, fraternity as the principles of life. So if someone is recognizing liberty, equality, justice, fraternity as the principle of life, then we must start believing that we are inching forward, or we have achieved the social democracy. Once we have achieved the social democracy, it would be more easier for us to achieve political democracy here in India. So for him, liberty, equality, fraternity and justice are to be treated as the separate items in a democracy, which are essential for to have a strong democracy in India. This was his entire idea of democracy, Ambedkar's idea of democracy. So our chapter on democracy is over on Ambedkar. Okay, first one is uploaded in the same link. You can see it. This is the second part. Next, I'll have my lecture for Hindi medium students on democracy. Please stay tuned to the lecture. Very soon, within maybe tomorrow, I'll upload Ambedkar's idea on democracy in Hindi. Okay, stay healthy and stay blessed. Thank you very much.